In a matter of days, a New York jury will decide the fate of Harvey Weinstein, who, as you know, is charged with raping and sexually assaulting two women and could end up spending life in prison if found guilty. In the end, his lawyers opted not to put him on the stand in his own defense, allegedly against Weinstein's own wishes.
What are you thinking about testifying?
He didn't have to.
Weinstein's attorney said they made a strong case without him, claiming prosecutors failed to prove the charges beyond a reasonable doubt. Of course, prosecutors disagree, and both sides will get one last chance to convince the jury when closing arguments begin tomorrow. But for now, some of the arguments one of Weinstein's lawyers made outside the courtroom are getting even more attention. Defense attorney Donna Rotuno, who's called herself the ultimate feminist, she spoke with Megan Toohey, one of the reporters who first broke the story about accusations against Weinstein, for another recent episode of The Daily Podcast. Here are a few clips from that interview.
Actually, I had another question, which was whether or not you've been sexually assaulted.
I have not.
Okay.
I have not. Because I would never put myself in that position. I've always made choices from college age on where I never drank too much. I never went home with someone that I didn't know. I just never put myself in any vulnerable circumstance, ever.
Do you think it's possible for women to be sexually assaulted by somebody that they know, even if they've taken precautions?
Sure. Anything's possible, Megan. It's not about what's possible. It's about trying to, again, minimize the risk. I'm saying that women need to be very clear about their intentions. I think women need to be very prepared for the circumstances they put themselves in. And I think absolutely women should take on equal risk that men are taking on. And the responsibility should be equal as well.
I'll let my guests weigh in. Tina Opie, Associate Professor of Management at Babson College. Hello, Tina. Head's about to pop off. Jen Deaderick, author of She the People, an Illustrated History of Women's Citizenship, and she is sighing. So I would never put myself in that position. So obviously, those who have been sexually assaulted, like little boys and girls at church, for example, right. have put themselves in that position. But while I had the same reaction you did, a lot of people think like Rotuno does.
Well, it's magical thinking to an extent. I mean, there's like this sort of hopeful, in a defensive thinking, it's to comfort yourself, to think maybe if I do all the right things, I won't get hurt. Mm-hmm. And it's true, you know, that you can, there are certain things that as women we learn not to do. You know, you don't leave your drink unattended. You don't.
We talked about
you know,
this beforehand.
We talked about this in the green room. You don't, you know, you try not to go home with somebody you don't know. But it's still like, that's also magical thinking. You know,
what I want to say is, yeah. I have children, and I give both of them wisdom about things like how you take care of yourself, how you make sure that you're safe. When we go to a collective level, though, we have to remember that even if something does happen to you, even if you forgot to attend to your drink and something happens, it is never your fault if you're sexually assaulted. I've been sexually assaulted as a child. It was not my fault. Yeah. It is never your fault. And I think this woman, I don't know what she was trying to imply. I think it's so dangerous and so toxic. She maybe believes that the world is fair. It's not.
I know exactly what she's trying to imply.
Obviously, of course.
It's the victim's fault. You've seen the hashtag where I put myself, where a ton of women and some men have described situations where they, quote, put themselves.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't want this to come out in a crass way. Other than that, it engendered rage. Does it really matter what she said? I mean, this has become almost a major talking point around this case. But does it matter in the grand scheme of things?
It matters in that it adds, it's one thing for her to be defending her client in court. It's another thing for her to be putting it out there in the public sphere, to be sending that message out there and to be blaming the women who were assaulted by Harvey Weinstein for having been assaulted is really
repugnant.
Yeah.
It's repugnant. And I hope she's gone to confession if she's Catholic.
So let's discuss something that clearly does matter. The prosecutor's decision in this case to go where very few prosecutors go. Every prosecutor is looking for the perfect victim. And I know it's a crass term, but that is, you know, that we're, but what they decided to do in this case, and I give them credit for, Miriam Haley and Jessica Mann are not the perfect victims. Yes, they say they were raped, sexually assaulted by Harvey Weinstein. They admit that they have had consensual sexual relationships with him. They admit that they have had conversations with him after they say they were raped. This is a big risk on the part of the prosecution, is it not? This doesn't work very often.
Well, so it's interesting because this is sort of a meta comment. If we juxtapose that question or that comment about the perfect victim with our discussion about what Ratuna says, the notion of a perfect victim is actually sort of aligned with what she said. Mm-hmm. And so I think we have to be careful in the media about using terms like that because, again, it is never the person who sexually assaulted. I understand what you're saying.
No, it's
you're
really like, complicated, and I know it is typical not to be the perfect victim, but that's what prosecutors avoid, like the plague, because they're impeachable, essentially.
Yes, they look,
and a lot of people don't get it. Well, if you were raped, as you say,
yeah.
then why'd you call the guy after the rape? What? Why did you have consensual sex with him after the rape? I mean, jurors... I mean, there was this great kid, my hometown of Philadelphia, a guy drugged and was accused of drug and raping 10 women.
Yeah.
I think it was in 2006. He was acquitted. Because a significant number of those women were honest enough to say the same things that Mann and Haley are saying in this case.
Yeah.
So this is a big deal. And it seems to me if there's a conviction, it opens a huge window that is a good one for rape prosecutions.
Well, right.
If he's acquitted, there's a real problem.
Well, it's like the change in the law when we decided that wives could be raped by their husbands.
That's exactly what I was going to say,
Because that's, you know, that was the whole, well, if you married him, then, you know, so it's this once a man has had sex with a woman, it doesn't mean he owns her and gets to do that whenever he wants, right?
But don't you think the average person who you stopped on the street might have a problem with that?
It would depend on how you phrased it. If you said to them, if you've had sex with a man, or if a woman
has,
does he have a right to just have sex with you anytime, they would say no. If you presented them as like the... It is harder when you talk about specific people, and you can sit there, and again, because it plays into what she was talking about the don't put yourself in situations, is there is an extent to which if you haven't been raped as a woman, you feel like maybe you did something right, and maybe you haven't been putting yourself, you know, and so there's that, I mean, it's something that, I mean, we start from when we're really young, hearing about how we're supposed to avoid being raped.
But my concern about this is if there is an acquittal, The company line is going to be is because they took a risk, the prosecutors, they shouldn't have. And my fear going forward, because I buy what you're saying, is they're going to avoid women who are complicated, where the stories are complicated, like in almost all rape cases,
no?
Well, so I think that's true. I mean, they're... Typically, they go for test cases, people who are unimpeachable. I mean, it's the same thing with the civil rights movement.
Perfect victims. I know you don't like it, but
I mean, like Rosa Parks was selected for. There was someone who preceded her, but she wasn't considered as perfect. Jackie Robinson. There were other people who could have integrated Major League Baseball, but they chose him for a particular reason. My concern here is that sexual assault does not always work the way. It's not cookie cutter. It's not always perfectly easy to ascertain the facts, and I get it. I have a son and I have a daughter. If my son is ever accused of sexual assault, I want to make sure that the justice system does what it's supposed to, and he's not simply found guilty because of some superfluous information. At the same time, I also want to make sure that if my son is assaulted, that there is support behind him and resources behind him that will try to get to the truth. And this case, unfortunately, feels like it may be a lot of wealthy attorneys who are trying to get this man off.
Well, this was always, this was always a complicated case because we're talking about actors. We're talking about actresses and who are already considered suspect and are considered too ambitious and are considered, you know, like, oh, they just... Don't have a lot of power.
They're at the bottom of the status
hierarchy. And if you're going to be, you want to be in a movie and Weinstein says, come up to my apartment, we'll talk about it, come up to my thing. And they're like, well, I don't know. I mean... It's Harvey Weinstein. What's he going to do?
Exactly,
and then he does.
What they said happened.
You know?
We'll have you back after the verdict, which could be any day now.
All right.
Jen, it's good to see you.
Good seeing you, too.
Tina, as always.
Thanks so much, Jen.
Thanks so much. Really appreciate it.